Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you're calling from. Welcome to today's webinar, the third webinar as part of the series on social protection responses to COVID-19. Today we'll talk about social protection and older people in particular, and what actions they are that can make a difference for older people. My name is Florian Jürgens. I work for a global NGO called HelpAge International. We work around the world on aging and older people's issues, trying to create and advocate for a world where older people are safe and secure, free from abuse, and have dignified standards of living. I'm their social protection advisor, and I'll be your host today. So welcome to today's webinar. Really excited to have you. Before we get started, I would like to just give you an overview of the serious social protection responses to COVID-19 and what's all included as part of this package. First of all, there's a task force that is kind of driving this initiative. It includes the German government, the Australian government, and the International Center for Inclusive Growth. It's all hosted on socialprotection.org. This I think fascinating and really timely initiative includes a weekly newsletter that is participatory, so people can share newspaper articles and reports on what's happening in the world of social protection, particularly with a focus on COVID. Of course, there are weekly webinars to foster discussion and exchanges between experts, policymakers, just people who are maybe new to social protection and are interested in learning more about what social protection can do to maybe respond to some of the dangers faced by this global pandemic, COVID-19. There's also an online community, which is to share, all these information. There's so much that's being produced at the moment. There's a lot of research. There's mappings of initiatives, of responses. Initial kind of evidence emerging on the pandemic itself and social protection responses to it. So that can all be accessed on this online community. You can check it out on socialprotection.org. As I said, this is the third webinar as part of that series. Before we get to today's topic, just want to share with you the next webinar as part of the series. One will be next Tuesday, and it's on G2P payments in the context of COVID, key areas of action and experiences from country emergency actions. G2P, I had to look it up. It's government to person payments. I think it is largely around cash transfers, but do look up the webinar itself, and I'm sure it'd be very interesting. A couple of days after that, on Thursday, we have an opportunity to learn about lessons, to hear about lessons learned and opportunities in linking social protection systems to humanitarian cash transfers. That's next Thursday. But now to today's webinar. We will have a Q&A session at the end, but please, as we present and as we talk and discuss, please share your questions in the chat box. Those will be collected, and we hope to respond to all of those at the end of the webinar. If we don't have time for all questions, we'll share a Q&A document that captures your questions and our responses. This will be shared together with a summary of the webinar at the end, maybe in a week or so, and just check out socialprotection.org for information. You can also engage with the discussion on Twitter. There are some handles and hashtags, so please do participate. Right, so we have a really exciting set of presenters and discussants that will talk about social protection and older people. What are we doing? What can be doing? What are actions that can make a difference? And I will now briefly introduce them to all of you before I start with a short introduction to the topic and then hand over to the presenters who will speak on various issues related to social protection and older people. So first off, we are very happy to have Gabrielle Kelly, a research senior research associate at the Samson Center for Aging Research in South Africa. She is a social and health policy researcher and has and focuses on social protection, aging, and person with disabilities in Africa. So she will, she'll join us right after my introduction and talk about kind of specific issues that, you know, specific measures that can be taken to protect older people in the payment of pensions. After that, we will hear from, we'll hear from Peter Lloyd-Sherlock. He's a professor of social policy and international development in the School of International Development at the University of East Anglia in the UK. He has extensive, done extensive research on older adults, older people, particularly in low and middle income countries, with a focus on social protection, health, and long-term care. At the moment, he's engaged with the WHO to develop guidelines on older people and COVID as part of their expert group. So we're really happy to have him. And he'll talk a little bit about the link between social protection, health, and what whether there are opportunities to link the two in the context of social protection payments at the, this particular pandemic. And then after those two, kind of research perspectives, we will hear from Cecilia Mbaka, the head of the National Social Protection Secretariat of Kenya's State Department of Social Protection. She has, a wealth of experiences around research, government policymaking, engagement with civil society. Previously, she was the head of the Division of Social Welfare and Older Persons, as well as the founding director of the National Council for Persons with Disabilities. So she's incredibly well placed to respond to some of those, some of those presentations made by Peter and Gabby, and in particular, give us a, give us a perspective of a country responding to COVID-19 through social protection mechanisms, and I think will provide a helpful grounding of some of those maybe slightly more abstract discussions. She'll talk to us a little bit about what's actually happening in Kenya at the moment, what the plans are of the government to respond to COVID-19, to cushion people from its impacts, and use social protection as the mechanism to do that. So really excited to hear from her as well. All right, that's me, Florian. Yes, as I said, I work for HelpAge. No need to say more on that. To the purpose of this webinar, why are we here? Why are we taking your time? And again, thank you for joining us. We want to do a couple of things in this webinar. We want to highlight how older people are particularly at risk in this pandemic. Obviously, what all people can contract COVID-19, and the disease can lead to very serious health health issues and even death, for everybody. However, there are existing research shows that older people are particularly vulnerable to the particular at risk to the health risks, health dangers of COVID-19. So we really want to just highlight that once more. I think it can't be said often enough. Following that, we will talk about how countries are responding to this this crisis, which is both a health crisis but also a social and economic one, and how social protection, particularly with a focus on older people, can help mitigate some of those risks that people are currently exposed to. Obviously, this is a time, I think, for a lot of interesting concepts being discussed and floated around, and people doing, fascinating creative thinking. But we also feel it's important to share, really practical guidelines on what can actually be done, here and now, to safeguard older people in the implementation of these programs, of social protection programs, particularly pensions. So the bulk of this, or the centerpiece of this webinar, will really be sharing these practical guidelines. So obviously, you know, after sharing these guidelines, we'll have opportunity to talk about how social protection provision can be linked to you know, health support, again, focusing on older people. We understand that this is a maybe primarily a health crisis that is either gradually developing or is, you know, causing, you know, a socioeconomic crisis as well. But, you know, the health is still quite obviously central to this crisis. So we want to try to link social protection with a focus on income with other elements of social protection, which, you know, include health. So, and then we'll hear from Kenya's experience and current thinking and what's actually being done at the moment beyond this kind of maybe you know, high-level global thinking. So we're really curious to hear what's actually being done at a country level. What's the thinking? What are the experiences? So this is the webinar that we'll have today. Really excited to hear from our speakers and obviously to hear your questions as well. All right. Okay. So just to set the scene, I have a couple of slides that I wanted to talk to you about. Social protection has been, and I think this has become quite obvious over the last couple of weeks, a critical component in countries' responses to COVID-19. This has, I think, has a lot to do with obviously, you know, people being asked to self-isolate, to stay at home, with essentially, you know, global economy being kind of put on ice as people are, as we're trying to reduce transmissions. And this has put, you know, tremendous pressure on or posed tremendous challenges for people to maintain incomes and living standards. So social protection has kind of jumped into, has been used by many countries to provide that income security, or at the very least, we're seeing a really impressive, I think, momentum of countries using social protection to respond to this particular shock. Whether that's, you know, adequate, whether that's kind of reaching the right people, whether that's enough support, whether it be, you know, it's a one-off thing, or whether that can be maintained through the duration of the crisis. Those are all really good questions. But at the moment, I think it's worth noting that there is this really, you know, almost across the board global response to the crises by expanding social protection systems. I think this is, you know, it's quite clear, I think, why that's the case. You know, we know that social protection can help people access health services, particularly where there's costs involved. It also allows people to adopt preventive measures. So it can help with, you know, people seeking, you know, kind of the right health services and advice. But also, and crucially, it can protect people's income and ensure income security, access to essential goods and services in this downturn, in this, you know, kind of grinding hold of the economy, where, you know, I think half the world's population currently is under lockdown. So, you know, for a huge proportion of the world's population, you know, income generating activities are, I'm at the very least, severely constrained, and that's obviously putting people's incomes and because of their livelihoods and living standards at risk. So that's kind of the scene. You know, there's a lot of people are struggling financially because of this crisis. Government's response to that has been, I think, you know, at least, you know, around the world, there are most countries that have implemented, they have either adapted their social protection programs or expanded those. And I think that's kind of the backdrop to this conversation. Okay, but, you know, that's great. And I think that's kind of the context in which we're having this conversation. But what the main message that we want to get across here is that, you know, throughout all of this, it's crucial to think through, you know, critically and continuously on whether these initiatives are, you know, protecting those most at risk from this crisis. That's something that needs to be evaluated, that needs to be, but, you know, continuously, but also I think from the start, we should be aware of who is really at risk in this crisis. And obviously, while everybody is potentially at risk, or everybody can be exposed to the COVID virus, and the both health and economic impacts of that, we do believe that older people are at the very least at heightened risk in this crisis. That we know that there are specific dangers for older people from a health, social, economic perspective that are being that derive from this global pandemic. Just starting with the health perspective, we know that older people are more likely to have underlying health conditions, and largely because of that, we see that the death rate from COVID-19 grows drastically with age. Early studies coming out of China show that about 80% of those who have died from COVID have been aged 60 or over, so are older adults. And in other global hotspots, particularly in Europe, I think where we're seeing similar figures with, this is a disease that it can affect it obviously, and it does affect everybody. And mortality is clearly not just limited to older people, and age in of itself might not even be the determinant of mortality in the context of COVID, but the underlying health conditions make it significantly more dangerous for older people, and that's something that I think we should be aware of. Starting with this health perspective, older people's heightened risk in that context, I think we shouldn't forget the other non-health consequences of this crisis. I said earlier that millions of people's, if not billions of people's, of livelihoods are essentially collapsing because of requirements to stay, to self-isolate, to not engage in income-generating activities, don't leave the house if possible, and that's obviously leading to collapses of incomes. And I think it's important for us to think about how that affects various members of the population, right? So I'm not saying that only affects older people, or that it even exclusively affects older people, or predominantly. I think it's too early to look at. It's too early to tell. But I think I have personally strong reasons to believe that older people's incomes and living standards will, if we don't act now, significantly decline as the result of this crisis. And for me, this is because the evidence we have about how older people, particularly in low middle income countries, are maintaining their living standards, and what we know about the existing fragility of their livelihoods and their income sources, which are always a combination of work, older people, particularly in low and middle income countries, obviously engage in a lot of paid work, a lot of unpaid work, of course, as well, but also a lot of paid work, particularly in the informal economy. Older people rely on savings where that's possible. We obviously know because of widespread poverty that isn't always the case, and that's not something that can tie people over for maybe extended periods. Financial support from family members is, it's hugely important source of income for older people. Particular as only about 20% of all the people, a little bit more than 20 people, but 20% of all the people in low-income countries have, guaranteed income security through a pension system. 80% have no such security. So they are incredibly exposed to these kind of shocks. And as families and younger people will struggle to make ends meet, it's, I think, reasonable to be afraid that there will be less money to be shared with older people, and older people receive less family support as a result of this crisis. I think this is where it's important, is that given the heightened vulnerability of older people to the health effects of this crisis, it's going to be, I think, quite a while until older people can maybe safely continue their income generating activities, In any case, there might be health guidance in some countries that all people should continue to self-isolate even after the worst of the crisis is over. You know, as the virus is going to linger, it's going to make it much more difficult for older people to generate their own incomes, I think. This is particularly important for older women who are less likely to have a pension due to, you know, a lifetime of disadvantage and discrimination. Will older women in developing countries, low and middle income countries, I'm sorry, have, you know, generally lower levels of savings and rely on family support more? So if that were to break away, then that's really a concern. So all of these reasons, I think, for me, are why we need to have a social protection response to COVID that is at the very least sensitive to older people's, you know, needs and rights, but you know, ideally directly focuses on the risk that older people are exposed to. Okay, sorry, I'm getting questions, which is fantastic. I just wasn't sure whether I needed to respond to those at the moment. But please do keep sharing questions, and we'll get back to all of those at the end of this webinar. So, you know, given this unique level of risk that older people are exposed to, but also the reliance of family support in the absence of underdeveloped pension system in most low and middle income countries, I think it's crucial that, you know, governments really fulfill their responsibility to ensure income security for all older people. So I think, I mean, obviously that's not new. The responsibility has always been there. You know, the right of older people to income security is not, you know, something that has only, you know, emerged as a result of this crisis. But I think the urgency is different. And in the context of, you know, widespread self-isolation, reduced incomes, you know, limited access to health and support services, and potentially also higher, you know, health expenditures, you know, for older people, it's crucial that at the very, very least, we ensure that existing social protection systems can continue to provide support to older people. But I think beyond that, we need to take this moment to think about what mechanisms we have at our disposal to protect you know, older people in this crisis, protect their income, protect their well-being, but also their mental health. Recognizing their very heightened risk in this issue, and you know, there's so much going on, and I reviewing the fantastic mapping of the World Bank and ILO, Gentilini, Almefi, and Orton, which is, you know, is referenced here. They're doing a weekly live mapping of social protection responses, which a lot of the information that I've so far presented is drawn on. It's a really fantastic read. I can only recommend you to take a look at this. I've tried to look at which countries are responding specifically to older people, and you see the map here. The countries in red there, they are doing something particularly focused on older people. And I wanted to highlight that, the kind of specific focus on older people in some of those countries, because I think general social assistance, you know, as many countries are expanding kind of poverty targeted, residual kind of general cash transfer programs, that's important. But I think there is a real risk that if we only focus on what we would try to, you know, what governments might think of the poor, which, you know, in of itself is a very difficult to identify category, and that may not even exist and is more of a kind of statistical construct. But in this particular crisis, where everybody's incomes are essentially, you know, hit hard, so hard, where people who might be non-poor before are now thrown into poverty, where people who, you know, where the income shock is much more universal, I think these kind of small poverty targeted cash transfers are not necessarily the way to go, and will likely leave many people out, and will very likely leave many older people out. Therefore, I think we need something else in addition to that. We can talk about this a little bit in the duration of the call. It's encouraging to see that there's about 34 countries that have adapted their old age social protection systems to provide better support to older people, but it's clearly not enough. And, you know, I think there's a legitimate there's a conversation to be had about whether those actions are sufficient and whether other countries could also follow those examples. Two more slides and then I'm done. There is some really good examples, I think, of countries improving their social protection system for older people. I think though this is just a quick kind of mapping organization that I've done to highlight some of the options and what countries have chosen. And I would recommend you know, listeners to think through what systems in their countries what systems exist and how they could be adapted to provide better support to older people. There's examples here from Sri Lanka, for instance, that increased their social pension from you know, substantively. There's a number of countries, Tunisia, India, Colombia, Hong Kong, and many others that are boosting old age pensions. So they're adding a kind of a one-off cash grant, whether one-off is enough, but anyway, it's good to see that they see these pensions as mechanisms to provide support for older people. Other countries, again, Sri Lanka, for instance, are adding more people to their, you know, essentially adding more people to a pension. So they have a waiting list for the social pension and they've just added those people onto the program, which is, I think, a good way to add to provide income security to more older people. There are some countries that have developed kind of ad hoc crisis response cash transfer. Some of those include older people, which is obviously good. But you know, how they can be reached and how we can make sure that we all in need receive the transfers is another question. And then there's another area of work here around the safe delivery of pensions. You know, this can be done. We'll talk about this actually in the next presentation. But they're you know, kind of tweaking the delivery mechanism to make sure that older people can receive their income and are not exposed to undue risk in collecting it. And there's a number of initiatives there. However, there's also some problems, some unintentional challenges that we see with countries. You know, I think everybody's just really struggling with this unprecedented crisis. So this is not to like fault any kind of blame really. There's just so much to do. And the challenges of both protecting populations while providing income support to those who are most vulnerable is clearly a daunting challenge. But there are some examples of countries where social pensions have been essentially suspended, because there was concerns about putting older people at risk when the transfers are manually collected. So that's understandable. I think you obviously want to minimize risk for particularly for older people who are, you know, very at risk to this virus, but cutting the economic lifeline of people is obviously not the way to go. And you know that now people don't have any source of income, so how are they supposed to survive, and is that not putting them more at risk? There's other countries where in an effort to protect bank staff, so people working in banks, you know, banks have essentially been shut. But there wasn't maybe a thinking around, would older people who receive their pensions, would they be able to use ATMs? In many places, they prefer or are only able to access their pension through bank offices. With those shut, you know, there's a real risk. I mean, you know, older people are being put at risk when they collect their pension. So this is essentially my, I think I probably spent a little bit more time than I should have on this introduction. This has been the framing, and with that, I would like to throw it over to we presenters to Gabby. Gabby, we've seen those final examples. We've seen those final examples of countries potentially and unintentionally exposing older people to risks when maybe there isn't a lot of thought put into the provision, the implementation of cash transfers. Is there anything we could, do we have any advice on how that could be avoided? It'd be great if we did. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. We put some time into developing what we hope are some quite practical guidelines for improving the administration of pensions over this time. Some of these suggestions are also applicable to the general population. The main goal of them is obviously to reduce social contact and protect people. So it is applicable to everybody, but I really do hope that what will come out of this presentation is the particular measures that need to be put in place for older people and the way that we need to communicate with older people. So the three main points that I'm going to take you through are how to reduce infection risk at pay points, information sharing in terms of media campaigns, etc., and then safety and security. So firstly, in terms of reducing infection, ideally we want to have as few people trying to access their pensions at the same time, and so when we want to reduce older people's potential exposure. So one suggestion would be to have staggered payment days. I know that in South Africa they have done this, and I think a few other contexts where pensions, say for instance, are normally paid on the first, payments began a few days earlier for older people and people with disabilities, so that they could access pensions separately from the rest of the population. Where that isn't possible, or on other days, older people should be allowed early morning access, similar to what some retail outlets have done, allowing people to go and shop earlier in the morning and get priority over the general population at other times. So in other words, not be forced to queue in the same way that other people might do. And then another option might be to pay pensions less frequently, every 2 to 3 months, but doing this in advance, obviously, rather than delaying people's payments over this very critical time. Have I taken you off? Sorry, let me just do that. Okay, and then developing plans to manage payments with external partners. In some contexts, the payments aren't made exclusively through a pensions agency. They might be made through banks, through retailers. And it's really imperative that proper plans be made in collaboration with these other organizations, so that they've also put in place appropriate protocols, so that they're queuing makes allowances for social distancing, that their appropriate hygiene standards are put in place. So for instance, if you're trying to get everybody to draw money from an ATM, what's been done to keep the ATM clean and prevent people from getting contaminated through the keypad. Also important over this time is to try and reduce administrative burdens that might require people to have to visit an agency office. So for instance, proof of life for older persons, that's quite common in some pension programs. And then also just in making these arrangements, recognize the likelihood of disability within this group, both sensory and functional impairment, so that if you're making new payment arrangements, that they are taking into account that older people might either struggle to access information about these new arrangements, or might struggle to access new payment points. Another solution to try and get people, older people, to be able to avoid going to kind of busy pay points would be to allow them to nominate a third person to collect the pension on their behalf. So this is obviously challenging. You need to make sure that the money is going to the correct person, and there are very large numbers of pension payments that are made in some contexts. So we've made two suggestions, but we're very interested in any examples of good practice or any ideas that people have on ways that you could do this smoothly and with minimal administrative burden. And in the short term, one suggestion might be to consider working with community organizations or religious organizations to collect and distribute pensions for their members or congregations at the pay points and then go to people's homes. Obviously, there are two elements of risk there. Firstly, that do the older people get the money? And secondly, are people, do they have the appropriate PPE equipment? So those are two things that do need to be considered. Perhaps a better kind of longer term solution might be to allow people to more formally appoint a third party, and that community health and social workers or payment agency staff, perhaps even community volunteers could visit people's homes to help and appoint a third party. And you could start this process by prioritizing people that might have failed to collect their pensions at the previous payment time. But then again, also it would be very important to have information and equipment available to protect home visitors. Another option to help older people avoid pension payout points would be to introduce electronic payments in settings where these may not yet exist, and also where it's feasible to do so. This is obviously becomes more challenging in more remote and rural areas. So some options include cash cards, mobile based e-wallets or payments collected at retail merchants. But yeah, again, this will depend on the context. If you want people to go to ATMs, then trying to encourage people to do this by waiving ATM fees and or encouraging them to use their cards as debit cards and not draw all their money at the same time if that's possible. But what is important, if you're going to introduce these new mechanisms for payment, realizing that older people might not have such easy access to technology, such as mobile phones. They might struggle to operate ATMs, and they need to be people available to help and support that. So there needs to be information campaigns to educate people about the options that are available, but then also community groups or perhaps officials that can help people to enroll in programs and to withdraw their money. Then if we're talking about pay points and also say retail outlets that might do payments, it's really important to have a screening protocol in place and hygiene protocol in place. The screening protocol might not be possible in all settings. It will depend on kind of healthcare work capacity, but ideally you'd like to have an area that screens people for COVID-19 prior to them entering a setting where there are a lot of vulnerable people. So if you have a body temperature checkpoint, you do external temperature readings where anybody with a fever, which is 37 degrees or higher, should be moved into a sheltered area, which needs to make provision for the health and safety of people that are put into that area and the people working in that area. Then in that space, people could then be given information and advice where to go for testing, or perhaps if testing is available, to do that there. And then provision should be made for people to be able to appoint somebody else to collect their pension for them that day or the next day, so that people are not avoiding. Yeah, so that people aren't discriminated against in terms of collecting their pension. And there needs to be a separate exit point so that those people aren't directed back into the main area in order to have to exit. Obviously, it's what we've learned from this pandemic is that a lot of people are asymptomatic. So it doesn't necessarily mean that if somebody doesn't have a temperature or any symptoms that they aren't going to be able to infect other people. So precautions are important when somebody goes into a main area. Just a lot of us know many of these things, so I'm not going to go to them in great detail, but obviously there's hand washing facilities need to be made available, staff need to have compulsory hand washing available, and if people are handling cash, they need to have hand sanitizer available and not kind of touch the hands of people that they hand money over to. So ideally putting money onto the table to allow somebody to collect it rather than doing it physically. Physical contact between agency staff and between beneficiaries and between beneficiaries as much space should be made as possible. So at least 2 meters, and creating space between desks and also using cleaning biometric devices regularly, particularly if it's something like a fingerprint scanner. So two examples of kind of good social distancing practices at pension pay points are shown in these photos. So the one is from Peru. We can see they've also taken it's the top one, where they've also taken the needs of older people into account by allowing them to sit. It's obviously long queues can make it very difficult for older people, and they've got the spacing, and they've also included, as you see, just very simple hand washing facilities. So it doesn't need to be running water in the setting. Grey water can be used as long as there is soap and people are washing their hands for 20 seconds, it should be fine. And then this other example is from South Africa in a retail outlet payment setting, where they've used shopping trolleys to separate people, which is quite clever. That's advice for kind of what to do around payments. What is also really, really important is for governments, pension agencies, communities, and commercial partners to share information, both about payment arrangements and how these might be different over this time, but also it's a really good opportunity to share public health information. It's a pension payout time. There's a lot of interaction with the public, and it's a good space to tell older people why that they are more at risk, how they can keep themselves safe, and what to do in the event that they do fall sick. So it's also very important that all engagement campaigns really do have a specific focus on older people, just because they are more at risk, and also because they might be less exposed to some of the messaging that's out there. And so I'll talk through some of those considerations shortly. Three key messages, the first being that older people must know that they are more vulnerable, but that they are not more likely to spread the virus than anyone else. And so that's a message that should go to older people themselves, but also needs to be spread in the greater community. And this is really to prevent discrimination and stigmatization of older people. So the payment points retail outlets are opportunities to share information. Written information can be made available, like pamphlets, but also, if possible, health workers or trained volunteers could be on site to share information and answer questions. So that would be in terms of health information. We also have put together these guidelines that I'm talking through are available on the socialprotection.org website. There's also another document, Key Messages for Older People, that informs older people on how to protect themselves, and that focuses particularly around how to protect yourself when you collect your pension. So I'm not going to talk through that now, but just so you can get some practical advice there on how to communicate with older people on what they should do when they go to collect their pension. But then prior to collection days, it's really important that the public has a really good understanding of how things work, because that can really undermine any efforts. If you have a whole lot of, if you don't have older people aware of the special payment days, for instance, or you don't have the general public aware of that, and you have younger people coming to the payment site, and there being a lot of confusion, it's going to create crowding and undermine the whole effort. So you really need to widely advertise payment plans using mainstream media, but also developing kind of local community strategies, and depending on kind of the kind of area it is, if it's a more rural area, I think community outreach is particularly important, and then also social media. But bearing in mind that older people have kind of lower levels of literacy, are much more likely to have sensory disabilities that prevent them from accessing information, or physical disabilities that, or cognitive disabilities that prevent them from participating in community life. Although, not many people are participating in community life at the moment, but they might be particularly isolated and less likely to be exposed in mainstream media and other messaging than other populations would be. So making information available in multiple formats is important. In many contexts, it wouldn't necessarily be feasible to have Braille and sign language interpreters, to reach populations, but where it is possible, that would be fantastic. Simple audio messages over loudspeakers in community settings would work well, and easy to read formats, like if we have pamphlets that that have pictures, and that everything is in local languages, so older people are much less likely to speak are much more likely to only speak a local language or dialect, so that needs to be considered as well. Community leaders and committees need to understand these new arrangements, and I think one of the best ways to reach older people would be through door-to-door visits. So if there is either communities could develop a list of where all the people live, or the social pension databases could be used to identify particular households that need to be targeted in information campaigns. Obviously, appropriate PPE needs to be made available to people who are sharing that information, they also need to have information on how to protect themselves and all the people when they do make those visits. Now, you can do a lot of media outreach and education around both COVID and new payment arrangements, and there's still going to be a lot of panic and fear and confusion. And so it is really important that that staff and well-trained staff are available outside of retailers and pay points to explain processes to people who have concerns. It's also important for this reason that appropriate kind of and sensitive safety and security measures are put in place to protect vulnerable groups, to make sure that they are able to get the special access that they need, to manage crowds, and to make sure that when people are have accessed their pensions, that they leave the payment pay point vicinity immediately, that there's no kind of hanging around and chatting, for this reason, that vendors and non-recipients also shouldn't be allowed to congregate in the area around the pay point. This might be challenging because where vendors are allowed to operate, pension payout time is a prime time for them to make money, I know that at least in South Africa, vendors very often set up stalls around a pay point, but this needs to be carefully and sensitively managed, so that you don't have all of the efforts at the pay point being completely undermined by everybody going in and gathering around vendors immediately afterwards. So those are our kind of our main guidelines. We would like to see these guidelines as kind of evolving and incorporating advice and best practice from around the world. If you do have a look at the guidelines and want to add anything, please do send us an email so that we can update those as we go. Thanks very much.
Great. Thank you so much. I need to view everybody. Thanks so much, Gabby, for this really helpful rundown through the guidelines. And maybe just to say, I'll mention this in a second as well. These are developed by a couple of people. We try to get them out, you know, as soon as possible so people can make use of them, but they're supposed to be live documents. So what we would like to put together is a small, you know, kind of informal working group of people who are interested in further contributing to these guidelines and working together to make sure that, you know, governments and policymakers access those. You know, after this webinar, if you're interested in contributing to those, and by the way, they now exist in Russian and Spanish as well. Sorry, I'm not sure whether you mentioned that. I apologize about repeating it. So they are on socialprotection.org, on HelpAge International's Knowledge Hub on COVID. They're available in Russian and Spanish and English. If you're interested in developing them further, you know, updating them, or maybe developing other guidelines that you think are useful, just drop us an email. I'll share my my contacts at the end of this call. Thank you very much for this really helpful and concrete you know, piece of advice. That hopefully is helpful for you know, for governments and implementers to think through what can be done to make sure that, you know, income support it continues to be paid in this difficult time. So thank you very much. I'll now throw over the we'll transition to Peter.
Just got a quick question, Florian, while you're still on your microphone. What time are we due to finish the webinar? Because I've got a message that we're running seriously over time. Do you know what time people are going to be leaving the webinar?
We started
52 minutes ago.
Then we have 40 more minutes left, roughly.
Okay,
that's the math there. Well, but we do have a little bit of time. Sorry, I've been doing a very bad job at timekeeping. So anyway, don't spend too much time on your presentation then. Thanks, Peter. Really, really appreciate to have you here. I'll just over to you.
Thank you. Yes, and thank you, Florian and Gabby. And clearly, there's been a lot of detail in the presentations so far. They're both excellent presentations, and there's an awful lot to take in, particularly in terms of those guidances. As Gabrielle said, they are available online, both on the Social Protection Org website and on the HelpAge International website, and they will be updated over time. So there was an awful lot to take in. It's all important detail. All of those details are very important. So please do try and study those documents in your own time when you can do that, perhaps with a little bit more time to focus on all the key points. I'm going to follow on quite closely with particularly what Gabby's been talking about, with some more specific ideas about, next slide please, next slide, thank you, about harnessing the potential of social protection to respond to coronavirus. I'm going to focus inevitably on older people, but I think a lot of what I'm going to say is also relevant to a number of other groups, particularly people with disabilities, but not just that group. I'm going to touch very briefly on three points. One is some general points about cash transfers and health outcomes. Then, again, linking in with what Gabby's talked about, pension collection points as a location of health risk, but also looking at pension collection points as a setting of health opportunity. So to start, next slide, please, with the first of those general points. It's sometimes claimed that cash transfers can single-handedly improve health outcomes among groups of people like older people. I beg to differ. My view is based on work I've done in Brazil, South Africa, and several other countries, including the paper at the bottom of this slide that was published just last month, and ongoing research that I'm doing in Peru at the moment. The available evidence shows that cash transfers, as a standalone intervention, have only limited effects on health outcomes for older people, for people with disabilities, unless other things are designed in, other kinds of things are included with the distribution of the cash transfer, which are specifically intended to affect health outcomes. And I'm going to give some examples of this designing in a moment. Next slide, please. We've already talked about the fact that pension pay points can be a location of risk for infection. I think this has been well dealt with. Bear in mind that the same also applies to, paradoxically, to health centres, to pharmacies, to many other health service providers. They tend to be places which are very crowded, where there are large numbers of people, many of whom have got symptoms of coronavirus and are highly infectious. Older people, some older people, particularly those with chronic health conditions, visit these places on a regular basis, often for routine checkups and to collect medication. If possible, they should phone ahead and see how essential those visits are in the context of the current crisis, and whether those routine services are still even running, because often they are not. And if a younger person perhaps could go and collect medication on their behalf. We know that health centres, health posts and pharmacies are one of the major points of infection in this epidemic, and continue to be so even in the context of lockdowns, for obvious reasons. Next slide, please. But I want to mainly focus on the opportunities to try and deal with coronavirus through social protection and linking in with pension payments. Despite what I just said, significant numbers of older people don't make regular visits to healthcare providers, particularly in poor and rural settings. They only have very limited engagement with healthcare providers. And so pension pay points offer a unique opportunity to reach and engage with these people on a regular basis, probably on a monthly basis. Before the coronavirus epidemic, I was involved in a pilot study providing hypertension services at pension pay points in rural South Africa that proved to be very effective. And now South Africa's Medical Research Council is building on that to develop a much larger study. And again, I've given a paper which refers to that work at the bottom of this slide. Next slide, please. So what do I mean by opportunities? Well, they include, as Gab has already referred to, providing information and communicating with people who congregate at social protection collection points. This can include guidance, both guidance of relevance to all population groups, or guidance which is more specific to the needs of older people, and those needs are extremely important. And perhaps more generic guidance or national guidance can be customized to the very local contexts where social protection is being delivered. It can include updates about the status of local health services, what's available, what isn't available, to inform people's decisions about seeking treatment, both for coronavirus, if they are worried that they have developed symptoms, and according to the severity of those symptoms, but also for many other healthcare conditions that people will still continue to experience, especially older people. And Gabby's already dealt with the fact that this can be provided in many, many different ways. And we need to bear in mind that we need to tailor those approaches to the specific needs and capabilities of older people in different settings. And of course, when we develop those messages, we need to liaise not just generally with health professionals, but with very local health professionals who know what's going on in the local communities to ensure that this information is appropriate. Next slide, please. More ambitiously, you can develop even stronger links with local health professionals and local health agencies to develop much more specific health interventions at pension pay points and other social protection delivery locations. And this was clearly what we have been doing in the hypertension work in South Africa. I know this kind of intersectoral collaboration is never easy to bring about, particularly between government departments that don't usually work together. But I think the potential benefits of doing so, particularly in this current context, are absolutely huge. And I assume that people would feel much more predisposed to alter their normal practices to take a more flexible approach to working across different government agencies. There are many possible interventions that might be offered at these pension pay points, and to save time, I won't run through them, but I've listed two or three just on this slide. And in the longer run, I would like to think, I would like to think that this isn't just something we do in the context of coronavirus, but this could pave the way for a much more holistic and joined up approach to providing cash, health, and other services to older people, as well as people with disabilities, as part of a much more coordinated, comprehensive, and holistic approach to social protection. As I said before, I don't think cash can improve health single-handedly. I've spent many, many years trying to persuade people working in social protection, particularly in the areas of providing cash benefits, that they need to explicitly bundle in health interventions with what they do. And it's very difficult to persuade them to do that. So these are my key messages. A couple of last points that occurred to me during this. I actually received a tweet, a blog which has just been produced by the World Bank on social protection for vulnerable groups in coronavirus by Burk Usler, which I think is very interesting. It talks about different vulnerable groups and cash transfers. It makes some very valid points about public health concerns around queuing and different ways payments could be safely made. There was a big problem with this blog. It refers to refugees, migrants, child brides, pregnant women, and many other vulnerable groups. It makes absolutely no specific reference to older people or to pensioners. This is quite representative of the marginalization of older people in global health discourse and in parts of development discourse, and it is unforgivable. We have done research based on a tool which has been published in the British Medical Journal that estimates that two-thirds of coronavirus deaths that are going to occur in developing countries, in less developed regions, two-thirds will be people aged 60 and over. If you work in social protection, and if you're trying to do something about coronavirus, remember that number, 67%. So that's all I've got to say, really. One last slide. I would like to slightly cheekily take this opportunity to advertise my own webinar, which I'm organizing with some colleagues, which is taking place tomorrow, 1 o'clock UK time, which is looking at primary healthcare services in the community, older people, and coronavirus in low and middle income countries. And you can find information about that. Don't go to the long and complicated link, but just to the simple link, coronaolder.com, if you want to join in with that. And finally, I would just like to pass on this message from my own mother, aged 85, currently in lockdown in her care home, who will be spending her 86th birthday on Monday in complete isolation. As she says, she's not ready to die just yet. And so we shouldn't be writing these people off. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. This, yeah, really, really interesting presentation. And I think particularly the last slide and the highlighting this, you know, the potential or the existing kind of disregard to older people in many people's kind of policymakers' minds when thinking about social protection is, I think it's always outrageous, but it's particularly shocking in the context of this crisis. So that's, I think that's a good, strong kind of wake up call, hopefully, and urging, you know, governments, policymakers to take older people more serious who are at the center of this crisis, really. To maybe hear from a government that is, you know, actively has made great strides in expanding social protection for various population groups along the life cycle and a very much of a rights-based perspective. And I think is making really important progress in that way. We'll hear from Cecilia Mbaka about what the current thinking of the Kenyan government is, what's already being done and what plans are, and just kind of provide us a contextualization, maybe a bit of a grounding of these kind of guidelines. And so we're really, really excited to have you. What's going on in Kenya? What's the thinking? What are the plans? Over to you, Cecilia.
Yeah, thank you, Florian. Thank you, Gabby and Peter, for that insightful for the insightful presentations on the COVID-19 as it relates to older persons. I know we don't have much time, and so I'll just go straight to what is happening in Kenya. As of yesterday, and I can see the Cabinet Secretary for Health is on TV already giving an update. But as of yesterday, Kenya had about 179 cases of COVID-19. 178 are moderate cases, while one was a severe case. We had 13 cases for persons who are aged 60 years and above, not forgetting that Kenya has a population of about 2.7 million older persons. Having said that, as you can see, the figures for older persons are quite low for now, and I say for now. And so most of the interventions that the government is making is really on the general population. And as it makes the interventions on the general population, then of course they will reach older persons. I know there has been very specific messages passed to older persons and very specific interventions on older persons, but generally what the government is doing is really to make interventions on the general populace and getting to the older persons. So far, we've not reached a point where we really need to focus so much on the older persons. Having said that, I would want to say that, as I said, there are very many interventions that are ongoing. On health services and support, the government is providing health support for COVID-19 cases in government hospitals, and those requiring quarantine are also getting free services from government hospitals. Private facilities are also available at a fee, and so older persons requiring health services then will be able to access them for free in government facilities. There's a lot of awareness creation also ongoing, and my prayer is that it's also getting to older persons. A lot of it is going through the word of mouth, through the media and other channels, and I think we are yet to know how far it is reaching to the older persons, but I can confirm that there is a lot of awareness creation that is ongoing. We have a lockdown in Nairobi Metropolitan, which was done on Monday the 6th. The reasons being that majority of the cases are found in Nairobi. And the thinking is that this will curb the spread into the rural areas. And as we know, majority of the older persons live in the rural areas. So the lockdown is going to help spreading of the cases in the rural areas. The other thing, as the Minister or the Cabinet Secretary for Finance has been giving the daily briefs, he has specifically addressed the youth, because he feels that the youth are energetic and they can unleash that energy in fighting the COVID-19. He has also specifically said that the youth are contracting the disease and taking it to the older people. And so he feels that the younger generation needs to be part of the solution, and they should stop traveling up country and to take the disease either to their parents or to the older persons. So you can see that is addressing issues of older people. And he even came out very strongly and told the youth that if you don't take care, you're going to continue burying us, we old people. So that that puts the, I mean, puts a sense in them on why they need to really take care of themselves, and so that they don't take the disease to the older persons. Kenyans have also been asked to stay where they are, to avoid movements to the rural areas, because this is where the majority of older people are. Other discussions that have been advanced is having payment service providers encouraged to push regular cities to the beneficiaries using the mobile wallet. Now, this is still a discussion, and this is what Ebi was talking about. And so that is yet to happen. So far, since our first case of COVID-19 was diagnosed, we have not had any payments. But what Gabby has shared with us today, it has already been shared with the unit that administers the cash transfers. And I want to believe that when the payments will be done anytime, then some of those guidelines will be used. Now, as Florian alluded to, the government of Kenya has allocated about $100 million towards the COVID response for vulnerable groups. Discussions are still underway on how these resources will be shared. However, considering that older persons are more vulnerable and the disease is taking a toll on them, as learned from other countries, they will be given preference. The beauty of it also is that majority of the older persons are already enrolled for the cash transfers. Out of the 2.7 million, about 0.8 million are already receiving the cash transfers. And some of those who are not already enrolled could be pensioners, and so they might not be requiring the cash transfers. Other discussions ongoing around giving urban slums, along giving these monies to the urban slums in selected counties, and especially where the COVID-19 is quite high. And these are the areas of Nairobi, the coastal or towns of Mombasa and Kilifi. But it is also understood that this will be a one-off emergency cash transfer interventions. And talks are that the ages could go as low as 60, because currently we're doing 70 plus. Other than that, as some of us may be aware, Kenya has two devolved, has two levels of government. We have the national government and the devolved units. And there are a lot of interventions that are ongoing at that level. And most of those interventions are actually reaching older persons. Like, for example, they are collecting data on older persons at that level, which is also including data on older persons. They are in one of the counties, one of the devolved units. We are also seeing devolved governments targeting squatters living in colonial villages, and it's likely that majority of the people in these villages are actually elderly people, so they are actually reaching them. So those are some of the few initiatives that the government is making, but I think as we move on, depending on how it goes, then most likely we shall see more interventions targeted to older persons. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Cecilia, for this really insightful presentation, and thanks for telling us what are the plans in Kenya. We have about 15 minutes left, so I think we would. I suggest we go straight to. To the how do I see? Okay, anyway, let's go straight to the Q&A session. We've received a large number of questions. I'll pick a few, and then we will, as promised earlier, we will send you essentially a Q&A document with some written comments, since if we're not able to address all of them right now. Could I ask all the presenters and discussants to please turn on their video so we can see all of you as you respond. The first question is, there's one here that I find interesting, it's essentially asking whether are there any interventions, or what is our thinking around, it says older people caretakers. So I'm not sure from the question whether this is older people who are caretakers or older people who are receiving care. I think both are probably interesting angles to think about. And I was wondering whether Peter had some thoughts on, care in general, with and, towards and from older people maybe in this moment.
Some very quick points, which I'm happy to develop in more detail in the written responses. Clearly, a lot of older people who get pensions don't actually pick up those pensions themselves, particularly the most vulnerable older people who've got problems with mobility, and older people who live in long-term care facilities in nursing homes and residential homes. So I think one key issue is to also communicate with people who may be collecting pensions on behalf of those older people, so that we're able to find out what's going on, and we can support those people, some of whom themselves will be older people, in their caring role. So messaging has to take that into account. It's likely that the highest concentrations of deaths from coronavirus in any country in the world, rich or poor, will be in nursing homes, residential facilities. There are many, many more of these in low and middle income countries than most people admit to. Many of them are completely unregulated and occur on a fairly informal, semi-clandestine basis. I think there should be an immediate amnesty for all care homes that aren't operating entirely legally, so that in exchange for their cooperation and control for coronavirus and managing coronavirus. And many of those long-term care facilities actually have somebody who, a representative, often the manager of that facility, who will go and pick up the pensions on behalf of their older residents. So there may be an opportunity to engage between social pension delivery or other kinds of pension delivery and those institutions. Because, we've seen what's happened in wealthy countries. In care homes in low middle-income countries, typically you will get six people to a room. The standards of hygiene are non-existent. So we are going to see the slaughter of older people in care homes in low and middle income countries.
Okay, so certainly an area to focus on and to think about in this conversation. There's another question here that maybe Cecilia had some thoughts on. The question is, and I'm not implying that Kenya is a low income country. The question here is, what can we do in contexts in low income countries where there isn't a pension system? Because I think when there's a pension system, it's pretty easy, as maybe Kenya is doing, to just increase the values. Do you have any thoughts? You might maybe countries kind of in the region, or how you as a government official policymakers would go about trying to provide income security, maybe when there isn't a pension system, I don't know. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Thank you, Florian. Yes, Kenya is a low mid-income country, and I think where there are no existing pensions, then the best thing would be possibly to introduce an emergency response. Because as I said, the 100 million US dollars that has been set by the government aside is actually a one-off payment that would last like about 3 months. So in that case, for those countries that do not have social pensions, then emergency response then would be a good alternative. Thank you.
No, that's great. Great response. There was another question on how do we reach people who live maybe in rural areas and where we don't have maybe they might not be enrolled in databases, we might not have information on them. In your presentation you talked a little bit about kind of internal migration And do you have any thoughts on how social protection could be provided to all the people who are generally not necessarily enrolled yet in schemes, or you know, where we don't yet have information on?
I think for me in my country, if you look at the social assistance program, they are in all parts of the country, including the arid and semi-arid areas, which are quite remote. And so we would utilize the same systems to be able to reach out to those who are in really disadvantaged areas. So I think for us as a country, we could be better off than in other countries that might not have such decentralized systems.
Okay, but maybe one takeaway here is that, you know, where, oh, bless you, I hope you're okay. That maybe countries where there is, you know, pension systems might be lacking, they will maybe have and other support systems, other social protection systems, which can be used to provide, you know, additional support to older people and others. Peter, please.
I think where clearly you don't have any kind of pension system in place, you have to look at other institutional structures which may have information about older people in those settings. And the two ones that occur to me straight away are religious organisations, churches and mosques, often have information about their congregations, or for want of a better word, particularly members of congregation who don't show up for one reason or another, which may be a very important indicator that something has gone wrong. So I think we need to work with those in new ways. And also, of course, except in the most remote rural areas and the poorest rural areas, primary healthcare facilities may exist where rural pensions do not. And for example, in sub-Saharan African countries, most sub-Saharan African countries do not have embracing pension systems in rural areas. Most, thank heavens, do have primary healthcare services in rural areas, although they're incredibly focused on mother and child health and conditions which aren't really relevant to older people. So they need to be very rapidly repurposed in the context of this epidemic.
Great. Thanks for jumping in there. There's another question that maybe I can quickly respond to. Peter, why don't you just stay, keep your video on. And by the way, sorry, unfortunately, Gabby had to leave the call. So if you have any specific questions on the guideline, you can ask them to us, or we, you know, we'll respond in written terms. There was a question here on what to do about refugees, particularly older refugees. I don't know whether anyone would like to respond to that. Otherwise, I think that's obviously a huge concern for it should be for everybody. Refugees living in you know, kind of very crowded camps, often excluded from national, you know, health and social protection systems, you know, limited ability to follow some of the social distancing, and you know, even kind of hygiene standards might not be where they are. So I think there's a real concern that if COVID were to make it to some of those refugee camps, that, you know, older people would be everybody would be very much at risk, and you know, it would be very difficult to protect themselves. I think I was just
emphasize though that I actually think that there are far more older people in low and middle income countries living in very poor standard long-term care facilities than in refugee camps. And although this isn't a competition for which is the most important issue, I think that humanitarian organisations are very focused on those sorts of issues in low and middle income countries, as they should be. But there is very little focus from any international agency about the hundreds of thousands of older people in low and middle income countries living in squalid, overcrowded and extremely dangerous, abusive long-term care facilities.
Okay. No, that's that's something I have to admit. I wasn't, you know, quite as high on even my, you know, thinking as so. Very thanks for highlighting that again.
Just one example: Argentina, they have got about 9,000 long-term care facilities. 9,000 in a single country with a relatively small population. These are neglected by everybody. Yeah. They exist, but nobody has them on their radar.
Okay. Well, I mean, thanks for highlighting it then, and maybe this call will at least draw some attention to it. Just want to say, in terms of what what I think can be done for refugees is, on the one hand, and I think provision of information is crucial, provision of, hand gel, and, hand washing stations and ability to kind of, wash your hands. I think that's crucial. Providing information to people in various languages about how to protect themselves, as well as, I think, wherever possible, the inclusion of people in national health systems, outside of camps, but potentially considering expansion of social protection systems, cash transfers to all the refugees as well. What's maybe particular about this crisis is that there, we're only as protected as the least protected amongst us. So I think if we don't manage to help, everybody, particularly kind of vulnerable people and old refugees, if they're not receiving the support to be protected from this virus, then nobody will really. So I think that the urgency is certainly there. Are there any other responses to that? Otherwise, maybe one more question. What do you have here? Sorry, hold on a second. I don't know if I can barely read my own handwriting. It's a mess. But maybe we'll take one more question. There's a question here about cash versus food. I wonder whether either of you has some thoughts on what's the point of giving cash to people if all the people are unable to access maybe markets, or if there's no kind of care and support to provide food to them. Does anyone have any thoughts on whether you think that's a challenge at the moment, or what can be done to ensure that all the people not that we can go beyond cash, and that all the people not just receive cash transfers, but that it can actually access the kind of goods and services that are important. Peter?
Cash and food, short answer. Give people what you can at the moment. It's not a either or situation. It's as simple as that.
Okay. Right. So we've had about 90 minutes. Unless there's any, there's many more questions, but I think those are the ones that we can, quickly respond to now. Are there any final words, Peter, Cecilia?
It was very nice participating in the webinar. I hope the information we have shared will be useful for the attendees. I'm sure many of us are doing different things in our countries, but I think the most important thing is to go for what works for us. Yeah.
Great. No, thank you very much. And we're really obviously encouraged to see the substantive social protection response in Kenya to COVID. And I personally look forward to hearing more about how additional older people and beneficiaries in general are being identified. What are the mechanisms of providing this additional support? So I think there's going to be a lot of learning we can all draw from Kenya. So thank you very much. Thanks for joining us, Peter. Any
thank you.
Final words? Sounds like you're about to be.
Very, very briefly, yeah, I would like to thank socialprotection.org for this opportunity, and to Florin for doing a really good job of bringing together such a wide range of important and detailed issues. I mainly work in health, so I don't often have an opportunity to address such a large audience, and it is a big audience of people who work in social protection. I think there's a range of specificity in what we've been talking about today, from very, very fine, small details about how to keep an ATM clean, to much bigger issues about why is it that we tend to obsess about providing cash and not combining the delivery of social protection with things that improve lives. And in the field I work in, looking at social protection for older people, we need to get over those bunkers. We need to have intersectoral collaboration. We need to bundle in services, care services, health services, and cash groups like older people, because cash cannot do it on its own. I'm a massive fan of social pensions, so I think it's giving people cash on its own has tremendous value. But my golly, do you multiply those benefits if you bundle in other services? And we need to get over these bunkers, please.
Great. No, I think that makes so much sense. Thank you so much, both of you. Let me just close by essentially just calling on all of you again. If you're interested in continue working, supporting this initiative to safeguard older people's well-being in this crisis, work on the guidelines that we have developed, update them. Maybe we need to develop another one a little bit more explicit about the bundling and what else can be done in this moment, what governments and policymakers can do to provide this additional support going beyond cash. Maybe that's an idea we should talk about. Anyway, get in touch with me. My email is here, florian.jurgens@helpage.org. Or reach out to any of us and we'll be in touch. We would love to hear from you. I think all there is to say is to thank all of you for joining. This is, I think, it's obviously a scary time in some ways, but it's also a very fascinating time in terms of the scale of new developments in the area of social protection, the urgency that now exists to do something about what social protection for all, make universal social protection a reality. I think is astounding, and is we hope that this webinar was part of that and contributed to that this momentum. If there's one thing I think that we want to maybe end on is just to say that as we develop all these new schemes and as we respond in real time to these shocks and crises, it's just really crucial, I think, for all of us to kind of, you know, continuously think through whether what we're doing is reaching the right people, is providing the right protection, is enabling access for all, and just kind of, you know, like really put the people center to what we do in the social protection world. So I hope that I hope this webinar focusing on older people, but I think a lot of the messages can be transferred to other population groups as well. And we hope this was helpful to all of you. So thank you very much. I hope you're all staying well in this difficult time. Enjoy a Easter break, if that's that's something that's celebrated in where, you know, places that you are in. And otherwise, all the best. Bye.
Thank you too. Thank you.
Thank you.